What's going on, everybody? Welcome to the place where you can find the latest NFT trends and the most reliable NFT content for entrepreneurs and investors. This is Above the JPEG with your favorite new friend, Kango Lin. Starting off this week, I have to admit that I talk way too much shit about PFP and art projects in the NFT space, but the guest today totally changed my paradigm. Quesadilla, you can find Quesadilla on Twitter. Casey is a brilliant young artist from New York, and she is creating a lot of crazy projects and teaching me about the art NFT side of the world as well as the people that she is serving. It's mind-blowing. You don't want to miss this.
Let's do it.
All right, Casey, welcome to the show. Welcome to Above the JPEG, which I'm so excited to talk to you today. I know that you've came to one of our Twitter space, and you're very brilliant young artist who's also an entrepreneur in my point of view. Let's get some intro from your side on your background, how you get into everything and what you're working on, basically.
Yeah, so I'll just give a brief kind of introduction to my background. I went to college with a passion for film, thinking that I was going to be a movie producer. And then soon after I got there, I tried VR for the first time. And I was honestly mind blown by the technology. And what I realized was I was passionate about film because of how it could impact people and move people. And when I tried VR, I was just kind of mind blown about the possibilities. So I ended up working at a variety of different startups in that space. And I also was like the president of the VR club. Like I get passionate and I dive really deep into things.
Where did you go again?
I went to USC.
Oh, that's right. The film school.
What'd you say?
The film school. I can tell you a very young person.
Right. That's a big reason why I wanted to go there. And soon after, got really into tech, worked at a bunch of different startups during school and then afterwards. And I ended up working with one of my prior bosses who became a huge mentor, and we were building VR experiences for mental health. So that was my introduction to that space. And he told me right away, you know, once you do something that has a lot of impact, it's hard to go back. So as soon as I had that experience, I really wanted to keep working in the mental health space. And I knew that I wanted to continue working in emerging tech. So I guess this was a year and a half ago or so, someone really close to me started talking to me about NFTs because I just so happened to have a crazy art hobby. So I was painting at night. This has been for the past probably 6 years, but I never saw myself as an artist. So they were telling me about NFTs. They're like, you gotta check this out. It's tech and it's art. You're gonna love this. So I was curious. I was a little skeptical at first, but what really turned me onto it was the opportunity for impact. Because I saw some sort of project was doing an environmental, had an environmental element where they were donating money to a cause based on their primary sales. And so that's what initially got me excited. And then I was just diving into different communities. And that was the element that I was surprised by, the power of the NFT communities. So anyway, I got involved. I started collecting and trading. And then in March, I launched my Genesis collection for my project. And the project is Project WANA, which stands for We Are Not Alone. And it all revolves around creating resources for mental health. And we do this through community, and I'm building a bunch of stuff.
You have the Project WANA behind you?
Oh, no, I did. I do have this. This is old. So this was before I was doing NFTs.
Wow, you're true.
My artwork.
Did you draw that?
So it's kind of like a mixed media. It's inspired by an artist called Mr. Brainwash, who does a lot of street art. These are like cutouts, and then it's like painted over. So that's just pre-NFT me as an artist.
You know, that's where it really got my attention, is that when you joined the Twitter space that day, you know, at first you were telling me, oh, you're an artist, you did the NFT arts and all that. At first I was just thinking, okay, it's another PFP project, or, you know, just another piece of art, right? And then I scrolled through your Instagram, not your Instagram, your Twitter, and I saw this electronic engineering thing going on. And then you were telling me there's something more you wanted to do. And I was just shocked. I was like, wow. Okay, so you mentioned about your art, and then you mentioned how you are going to allowing people to be able to create art with this device somehow. Tell us more about that, right? Just tell us more about this whole project. Because I'm a big I'm guilty of this. I talk too much shit about PFP and art. I talk way too much shit. I think a lot of audience that are listening to this podcast doesn't necessarily have that artistic understanding, right? Doesn't have necessarily have that community-driven understanding. Help us, walk us through how that works, right? How that is just not just an art.
Totally.
How did it go from art to something bigger?
Totally. So first of all, I totally understand your perspective, because a lot of people do see these projects that, you know, it's confusing. It's like, why is this so valuable? But I know, but when you look kind of under that outer layer, there's a lot of really fascinating projects going on. And something that I also do is NFT curation, because I want people to see the projects that are doing really awesome work. So I'll send you that. I don't remember if I did or not yet, but
I think you did. But definitely send me that again so that way I can link it down below so that everyone else will be able to check it out. Because it's so confusing in a way, not just that it's confusing that, oh, how does this work? But also because there are so many people who are literally, they are just creating, you know, PFP projects. And it's hard for people to have that time and figure out, oh, who's who, right?
Totally. Yeah. Some of them are, a lot of people are saying it's part of the culture. Like a lot of meme NFTs, but anyway, that's its own category. That's kind of separate from what
I do. That's its own category. Okay, I'm learning something again.
Yeah, you know, PFPs in itself are their own category. I don't think I'll ever have, I'm pretty confident I'll never have a PFP type project. But anyway, circling back, we were talking about like communities and what makes NFTs interesting. I am very passionate about merging tech and the problem of there not being enough access to mental health. And there's a lot of layers of issues that exist. Mm-hmm. And what I saw was an opportunity to bring people together. And what we can do is experiment and test things out and see what works, because I'm not seeing that much innovation in that space for the amount of technology that we have. And so a big question I always ask myself is, how can we combine technologies? We have AI, we have VR, now we have NFTs, Web3, all these different things. How can we combine those together? And so for me, I just like building things. So I was really curious, how could I create a project that's driven by biometric data? So I started with a heart pulse sensor. And then a week or two ago, I started working with, it's basically a sweat sensor. Like it detects the like electricals in your fingers and your skin, and it's correlated to stress. So
and nowhere in your resume mentioned anything about electronic engineering background.
You know, honestly, I know I was telling you this, but YouTube is amazing. YouTube and Google. And also, I forgot if I told you this, but my dad is huge on electrical engineering. And so I think over time, that interest just kind of built. It was really just a curiosity and an experiment. I didn't think or know it would be very possible. Like where I am now in the building process, I had no idea I'd be able to take it this far. But what I was able to do a week or so ago was using this sweat sensor I was talking about. You can actually create art that shows like you breathing. And there's different elements to this. Like, yeah, so I'm looking at your face. Yeah, so I was saying it can detect stress and different emotions. I quite literally, I'll send you a link, it's on my Twitter. I had the sensor on and I'm watching the chart. And as I breathe in and breathe out, it goes down. And it's actually wild how quickly I was able to put that together. And so like you were saying, there are very artistic elements to it. Like in theory, someone can create art with their biometrics. If I just make some sort of generative algorithm. But what I'm hoping it'll end up leading to, which is my long-term vision, is being an actual tool and resource for mindfulness, relaxation. It's been fun so far.
Yeah, I mean, that's a grand vision, right? That's what it really caught my attention, is that it wasn't really going to just end there. There was something more. It was actually more entrepreneurial than what I first initially thought. And I think there's more people out there that are doing very similar stuff. So I thought this is really such a great niche, such a great aspect of the NFT space that I didn't really understand. Not just art, but also how you go from art to a tool that people can eventually use and solve real world problems. That leads me to one of these questions I asked you, and one of these questions that you answered with a shocking amount of information that I didn't have before, was that massive audience versus niche NFT buyers, right? Yeah. So, from my perspective, I'm an entrepreneur, and I have really just been from the perspective where we got to build product, tools, solve problems from day one, right? And our audience are always going to be the massive international, the massive audience, right? The general folks. But you mentioned about something that was really dramatic to me. It was really impactful to me, was that you mentioned that the NFT buyers, they're buying your art, are different, right? They're not massive audience.
Yeah.
And you mentioned that they buy it because they identify it as something cool and something trendy. Mm-hmm. That's why they're buying it, right? So give us more of that. Yeah. Like that one was something, I think most of the people who are going to listen to this podcast will be really interested in understanding.
Yeah, so what's interesting about NFTs, and it still depends on the audience, but a lot of people care how things are built because you can quite literally see it. Smart contracts, you can read them and see how the code is written, and the elegance of the code and the way it's created and the innovation is part of the project. And what I was thinking about recently was there's almost this spectrum of, I'm just going to use Web 2 and Web 3 as an example. So Web 2 being accessible, people understand it and use it. Web 3 being future focused, less accessible, maybe more expensive. And I lean towards the Web 3 side. I don't think there's a right or wrong. I think they're both really important. But since I value efficacy, so basically I'm willing to create something that is successful in helping with your mental health, no matter what technology I need to use, what hardware I need to use. So in that case, I am sacrificing accessibility. And so it kind of goes to that audience thing. So I can make a project that's really accessible, but not very good at what it's supposed to do. So like, this isn't a nice thing to say, but an example is like Headspace or like meditation apps. They're really accessible. Could it be better? yes, but then they wouldn't be able to reach as many people. So I'm at a place now where I'm using the most emerging technology that's not accessible to everyone in the hopes that over time it will become more accessible. So it's almost like my audience is a beta group, like a beta tester. And then when I see what works and what actually helps people, I can focus on the accessibility. So it's almost like starting with that niche audience that understands the technology and is really interested, and then I can make it more accessible to the general audience. Oh wait, did I lose your audio? Oh, you're on mute.
My goodness, that was terrible. So it almost seems like it applies to all the Web3 projects, right? A lot of Web3 projects today, they are exploring a way that they can build something in Web3 that could potentially give more accessibility to the massive audience.
Right, yeah.
Is that what it is?
There's definitely, like, I think people are all across the spectrum. There are projects that are focused on bringing NFTs to the masses, quite literally. So they need to educate people on what NFTs are. A good example of this is there's an NFT project called My BFF. It's like a women empowerment type of project, and they were trying
to onboard. Yeah, on Twitter.
Yeah, yeah, it's pretty big. They have a lot of celebrities involved, like Mila Kunis, and so it's gotten a lot of buzz. But their audience are the masses, like women, non-binary people, like anyone who wants to learn about NFTs. So they have to educate them, teach them about NFTs, and then sell it. And that's like the business perspective. But for me, the people that are interested already know about NFTs. They already know what generative art is. And it's kind of like a shorter cycle. Like if they like it, they'll buy it at that point.
Do you think we'll eventually convert the mass audience into Web3? Because here's how I see it, right? I think Web3 is just the next phase of the internet, right? We're moving towards the internet that could potentially have more, potentially be more permissionless and borderless, bring back some of the good stuff from Web1. It's just very natural. That's going to be the next phase of the internet.
Right.
How do you think the audience who are not doing the Web3 today will be able to come to Web3 and, let's say, use your product? Would that done through the product makers themselves, or would that done through some sort of adoption where people who don't want to adapt to it would never be able to understand it? How is that going to work in your image?
Yeah. That's a good question. I kind of see it going like converging over time, because I was just saying, like, I want to work with the best, wildest technology right now, which is not accessible, but over time it'll become more accessible, like the whole gas fees issue on ETH. I think over time it'll become more accessible, and at the same time, through big companies, like huge companies are starting to question what they can do with NFTs. Some will be more straight up utility. Like, it's not all going to be art. It's going to be, you know, ticket sales and verifying designer products and stuff like that. So it'll be interesting how everything transforms. I think the art kind of section will remain, but other categories will emerge that will be a little more normal, I guess, for the everyday person.
That's what's the massive audience. It could be in a way of, it could be in a way of just storing money decentralized, in a decentralized manner people don't even need to understand the tech, right? It could be something like that, I think. And, but yeah, I think that remains a question where, you know, we have to just watch it and see how it's going to unfold, right?
Yeah.
A lot of things I don't know. That's why I'm on this podcast, honestly, just exploring with everyone, people like you, who are doing extraordinary things, and trying to figure out what people think about this. I have my own perspective and worldview, which probably there's mistakes in there. So really get a great look into what other people from different parts of the NFT world look at the whole situation really helps me that. And market downturn. Yeah. Right, we gotta talk about market downturn because this is honestly my first market downturn ever since I got into the crypto space seriously. Yeah. Right, because last one was 2017, and right after that, it wasn't doing very beautifully. But this is the first market downturn that I'm seriously in. What do you see that NFT art market is going in terms of this market downturn? And what do you recommend other folks do in this situation?
Yeah, so I'll start by saying I don't identify as a trader, because I don't really have the experience to do that. And if I tried, I would probably lose a lot of money. So I'm really more
artist, you know, like as an artist, like, are you worried? Like people are not going to buy more.
Okay, sure. Well, you know? I was going to say too, though, I am a collector. So I have NFTs and I'm a holder of crypto. And like you said, I have my own art through all of this. But I truthfully, I'm not scared because, like in my particular circumstance, I'm building regardless of the market. It really has nothing to do with what I'm making right now. I have a feeling that, I mean, not everyone knows. I have a feeling it's gonna come back. And when it does, a lot of projects are no longer gonna be here. And I think that was necessary. Like we kind of needed a period where people fell off. Like the ones that are really not in it for the right reasons, or you know, not cutting it in terms of quality. So, you know, I'm okay with that. I think it's kind of natural that this happens. It's a cyclical thing. And I'm not gonna give anyone advice, but what I'll say is Zeneca is an awesome person to follow. And if I'm gonna give advice, I would basically just be referring to what he's been writing on his Twitter. So I recommend doing that.
As a collector or as an artist?
Both. So yeah, and a lot of people are both. A lot. Go ahead.
More about the collection part, right? Because I wouldn't call myself a collector. I did buy like things here and there. Nothing significant. What do you normally buy? Like, because when I buy stuff, it's either starting off with CryptoKitty, and then there was some PFP stuff, bought it for fun, and then it was never art, you know, It was either PFP or just games, right? So what do you normally collect?
Yeah, you know.
Why do you collect, right? Another question. Why do you collect?
So there's the art, where there are creators that say, you know what, you're buying my art, there's not gonna be any more utility, that's what you're getting. And there are also creators that are quite literally creating utility, and utility can be really anything, it's just a benefit. And you'll see some that are tangible and others that are intangible. Like for example, 10KTF is a project I really love. And if you're a holder and you participate, you get rewarded with airdrops. That can be very valuable. So you're quite literally like making money financially by holding this NFT. And there's others that are less tangible, like everyone talks about communities, but really, really big ones are like Zeneca I mentioned. He has Zen Academy, and it's like something like the 333 Club. And then there's another community called Proof. And these are all like really desirable communities to be in, because you have access to all these different people. And soon they're gonna have collaborations with different tools. So if you hold this NFT, you'll get a discount on this product, or you'll get access to an event. So it's the creativity is crazy. You can really do whatever you want, but there are NFTs, like if you hold them, you get value in different ways. Oh, you're muted.
And I also think that's a curse as well, right? Sorry about the unmute problem. You know, from here, I shouldn't unmute myself. That's so awkward. Imagine people who's listening to this. I'm sorry, guys. But I think that's a bliss and a curse as well, right? Because a lot of times we hear about, and that's what I've been personally observing, correct me if I'm wrong, is that when I see a lot of projects and when I see a lot of NFT-related stuff, people would say, hey, man, there's so many things we can do. We can do A, B, C, D, E, F, G, right? But the problem is, okay, give me something concrete. Like, what exactly are you trying to do, right? Mm-hmm. So that way I can see if it's relevant to me. Because if you tell me about, oh, I am creating this project and it has a wellness component in there and how am I going to do that? I'm going to send you a device and you can use that to monitor yourself to see how well you are. The better that you take care of yourself, maybe the better, the cooler art that you can create with it. And then you can potentially monetize that and become an influencer. I don't know, you know, give them a, it seems more concrete, right?
Yeah.
And I know what I'm going to do as a person who's potentially picking on NFTs, but that's what most of the problem is that it's so, you can do anything with it, but people don't give you the concrete stuff, right? That's my frustration, honestly.
Yeah, there's a lot of roadmaps. I think this is what you're referring to. Like people kind of...
But the roadmap is really irrelevant a lot of times if you see the roadmap. They're like, oh, we're going to put this NFT in this game, that game. But we don't even know what game, right? And if this
or
is
like we're play, building,
probably not.
Yeah.
Totally. Right, so that's my biggest problem. So how do you source it? Like when you're collecting it, how do you source it? Because you don't have to read everything, I bet.
Yeah, I guess one way to think about it is you're almost like an early investor if you're collecting, because that's kind of the point. Like these projects, unlike how companies work now, they may not need to get traditional funding, and rather they fundraise through NFTs in order to build what they want to build. So that's what is interesting. But I get what you're saying. Like, you don't really know if it's gonna happen, come to fruition, which is why it's risky. But there's other projects that have been around for longer that have proven themselves. Like I've mentioned 10KTF before. That project has been around for a little while now, and it continues to be communicative and keep the project going. A newer project is going to be more risky unless it's a team that you know. So for me, when I'm collecting, it has to be something I believe in, because it is so easy to get caught up in hype and get just in trouble.
So what is a NFT project that you actually collected and then you actually was able to get some utility out of it?
Okay.
Give us an example.
I used 10KTF. Let me think of another one. This is kind of a boring one, but just to kind of explain how this space works. I'm in this one project called Alpha Girl Club, which I really liked because they were very wellness focused, and they're kind of like what we were talking about before. They're building a mental health app, and they're using their community to be beta testers and to test it out and improve it, which I think is really cool. But these communities have different giveaways and stuff like that. I was able to get an allow list for another project that minted, which ended up being really valuable. So it's like, it's hard to explain almost. Like these things just kind of happen.
I understand, right? So hard.
What did you say?
I said it's so hard to explain because it's almost random sometimes.
It's
random things happens.
Yeah.
And this it's hard to explain. And I think a really huge part of it, you keep repeating, was a community.
Yeah.
And what did you do in that wellness community?
What did I do?
What do people do in the wellness community, the NFT that you purchased?
This project specifically, when we were talking about like leaning towards Web 2 versus Web 3. They definitely are, they come from like traditional tech and they're more on the Web 2 side. So they're trying to make a mobile app using the feedback from the community. And a lot of projects, oh yeah, what were you saying?
I said interesting.
Yeah, it is interesting. And that's what's cool, because I come from like marketing and product and all this stuff where you have to like find your users and do market research and user research. And here it's like, it's all right there for you. Like your community is your audience. And so you can learn from them. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Learning is a huge part, especially in the Web3 nowadays. So what's been going on with NFTs lately, and anything new that you want to share? Because I mean, there's a lot of things happening in the crypto space lately, about Celsius, right? I don't know if you heard about that. Haven't heard a lot from NFTs lately. What are some news, maybe some insider news even, that you've been hearing lately?
Yeah, so I will say it's also kind of chaos right now in the NFT space, just because it's obviously very correlated with the crypto market. Yeah. But yeah, where to even start?
So you got a lot, because I don't have any.
Yeah, so this is just kind of random and interesting, but Satoshi, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, but created the MFers. If you've seen that collection, it's very meme-like. Basically, he announced, I'm going to disappear forever. It's like,
Satoshi, the guy who created Bitcoin, or is it another Satoshi?
No. It's a meme version of it. It's like this NFT creator who created, it's called the MFers.
You have a computer in front of you?
Yeah.
Can you share a screen?
Oh man, let me see.
We'd love to check it out. She's like, oh no, guys, don't look at my screen. Privacy.
I don't know what you like. MF. Okay, wait, let me. My Wi-Fi is a little slow, but let me try this.
It's just so interesting. It's kind of suffering for the audio listeners, but we will explain it with our words.
Is this working?
Okay. Yeah, it's working. MFM. Well, how'd you pronounce that?
MFers.
MFers. Okay.
So this is a collection. It's a pretty like blue chip type thing. All these drawings are by Satoshi, which is this creator I was just talking about. And
Satoshi, okay. Not Satoshi, okay.
What was it called? So what happened was, I'll find it. He announced on Twitter that he was gonna disappear. And basically it had to do with, apparently it's part of the meme. Like the collectors weren't upset. It was like, oh, we knew this was going to happen. And so what he did, he was like, okay, so I'm about to disappear, but until midnight, you can mint this Goodnight MFers NFT. It's going to be the last one. And it's kind of an homage to the NFT that started the whole collection, because it was called like GM MFers. And so I'm just bringing this up because it's really wild. Honestly, because in this market, he made this announcement, and I think a lot of people were emotionally tied and also like had FOMO about not being in the other community. So a ton of people bought it. It was an open edition. Supply was crazy. 17,000 were minted at 0.0. It was either 0.06 or 0.08, but it was higher than the floor is now.
And it's the exact same picture.
Exact same picture. It's not about the art, you know? It's like, yeah. It's like a cultural, like everyone was tweeting, it's for the culture.
That's crazy. How did they form this? Like, it's all online. You know, like nobody met each other or anything.
Yeah, it's community. Like people were bummed to see the creator go. The Twitter was deleted, the Twitter account. Yeah, so I thought that was pretty wild.
My God, that's some crazy stuff.
230 ETH volume.
I mean, Casey, why do you always introduce this cool stuff to me? Like, how come I never find out about these type of things?
Let you know.
I feel so lag behind. How do we like keep following up with this crazy stuff? Because this is crazy, right? If you think about, these are a whole bunch of people who've never met each other. Correct me if I'm wrong. And then they all share this strong sense of common jokes. They laugh at the same thing. It almost feel like, hey guys, we all watch sports. We all watch baseball in America. Right. And we're gonna crack some baseball jokes. That's basically right. This. We all have Satoshi NFTs, and now we're gonna crack one last Satoshi joke.
Yeah.
And it freaking worked.
Yeah, or even like, because people who wanted to be part of the other collection.
3K owners.
What'd you say?
7.3K owners. 7.3K people minted this last joke.
Yeah. Honestly, a part of me wanted to, because it felt very monumental. And I was like, I kind of want to just do it like for the culture, but I didn't, because I was like, this isn't worth it for me right now. But, and also the supply was going crazy. I knew the floor would go down, but it's really interesting.
Interesting, because you're explaining it from a part of the community. As part of the community, here's what I think as KC, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's wild, because I think a lot of it also was kind of FOMO. Like some people probably thought this was going to, or people probably think this will go up over time. It's just hard. The supply is so high.
Yeah, 17K, that's a lot. What about the other project that he created?
That Satoshi did?
Yeah, he didn't dot himself, right?
No.
GM.
Yeah, GM MFers was like the start to it all.
How many people? Oh, dude, what? So that one is 420 ETH?
So there's only one of these.
Oh my goodness, that's so crazy.
It's listed for 4.269, of course.
How
it
much?
Doesn't look like there's any sales shown on here. Yeah.
Yeah, I'd be curious how much he actually sold this for.
Yeah, I know. It's maybe because it's on Foundation, but it's not showing the sale prices here.
Well, this is fascinating. Well, thank you so much, Casey, for sharing this GN Satoshi meme with us. I guess a lot of people like me and the people who are outside of the collection space really got a chance to understand, well, at least got a peek to understand, like, hey, why people are doing these crazy things that we're hearing on the news, right? Part of it is because somebody was really able to put together a community by having people to buy these odds and get them to basically grow into some sort of community culture.
Yeah, and it worked. Totally.
That's crazy. Like that. Mm-hmm. Is that part of the plan as well for the project that you're building today?
Yeah, so it's hard because like, these type projects, they're funny. Like
they're memes,
they're playful. Like the apes too. Like it's a similar type of like tribe and community. And it's hard because my stuff, I'm trying to figure out that balance because I do want it to be like serious.
That's right.
Because I'm trying to do something serious, but I mean, I want it to be fun. So maybe I can mix in some memes.
Community culture. It doesn't have to be funny, right? It has to be, it's just community culture. Like people buy American flags. That's not even funny, right? There's nothing fun about American flags, but yet a lot of people buy them.
True. Right? So true.
I think it's just culture. In California, we don't want to buy Californian flags. You don't see Californian flags everywhere. It's really hard to see Californian flags. But then when I first moved to Texas, my God, everybody has Texan flags, really? Right? So it's just, that's where I see something that can be moved onto the online communities is that it doesn't have to be funny. It doesn't have to be always be a joke. It's just something that people want to be a part of, right? In Texas, people have a lot of pride in being part of Texas. And in California, we don't, right? In California, part of our pride is not be anybody, not belong to any categorical group, right? So I think what you're building, it doesn't have to be funny, but there's great potential in people taking a pride in that. I almost think people do take pride in Headspace sometimes.
Yeah.
Right? Like, don't you think? Like, people are like, yeah, man, I use Headspace and like, I meditate.
Yeah. Right?
It's almost definitely. The edge of like, hey, man, like, I meditate. I'm cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm trying to help people form those habits. So you would think that it would create some sort of camaraderie and community. One more thing. You reminded me. One element I'm trying to do. So the part of my project I didn't talk about was the concept of like gamifying mindfulness and rewarding people through NFTs and all of that. Something I'm trying to play with still within that is how to create something that aggregates everyone's effort and like rewards everyone together as a community. So like if everyone reaches a certain milestone or like a certain community, then you'll get rewarded. Like it's a team effort. Wow.
Oh, that's that's right. What if I think this is gonna be so fun because the community as the collective whole, now it's motivated to go towards the same direction.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Yeah.
I know. It's so fun, isn't it?
Like, that's interesting. I want to see how that goes for you, honestly. We got to get another episode together one day. Because
I know we should. It's
probably the longest episode I've recorded. Honestly, just so juicy. Because, again, I have a lot of understanding on the NFT aspect that I do, which is NFT infrastructure. But, I just don't understand everything about NFTs, right? Talking to you was one of the most fascinating experiences. Most people I talk to, they think kind of like me. But Casey, you think different from me, and in a really great way, in a very educational way. So I learned a lot from you. I learned a lot from you today. I learned from you a lot from you during your time at Twitter Space. How can people find you online?
Yeah, I feel like the best these days is Twitter. So I also have an Instagram they can follow, but Twitter is where it's at right now for NFTs.
Twitter is where it's at.
So yeah, I'm on it a lot. And if anyone wanted to DM me questions or like wants to know about projects, I'm very open to that. I'm actually gonna be curating soon with this startup called Bubbles, which they're basically like trying to curate NFTs and like have curators involved so that people from the outside or like who are already involved can learn about projects. And then also you can like keep up with projects because that's honestly really hard.
That's a huge problem. That's why a lot of people can't figure out what the fuck NFT is, right? It's because you just don't have that time to go in and read anything.
Yeah, 100%.
Somebody simplify that. But well, thank you so much, Casey.
Yes. You're welcome. I was just going to say, I'm going to leave everyone with one more thing because I want them to continue down the rabbit hole. If there's one artist you need to look at, it's PAK, P-A-K. It's an anonymous artist. No one knows who they are. And one of the biggest that exists, plays with mechanisms. I could talk about it forever, but I'll leave you with that. There's a YouTube series by The Defiant. On PAK, and you should check it out. DM me about it because, again, I love it. It's all like really interesting mechanisms and really pushes what's possible with NFTs. So
wild. Send me the links, by the way, Casey. Send me the links.
Okay.
I'll leave it for all the people who are listening.
I got you. I'll send you links.
Sounds good. Thank you so much, Casey. I wish you have a wonderful day.